guys, welcome here to Tactical Tuesday episode 6. Yes, the 6th episode. This should be like, you know, 12 or something, but I apologize, as hopefully most of y'all know, it's just been really busy and such with school and, you know, just tons of things and the holiday. You know, Christmas was here, so, you know, I was running all over the place and just wasn't able to get any episodes in. But anyway, but Christmas is, you know, come and now is gone, you know. If you watched my bonus shot episode that was last week, I believe, you know, I was talking about what I got for Christmas and stuff. This is actually a late Christmas present. It says, "Keep calm and march for McCrag." Now, I'm not sure if it's exactly heresy to wear a 40K t-shirt in a bolt action video. I guess I'll find that out in the comments. But, yeah, I guess I took a gamble, but, yeah. I love this shirt. It's awesome. If you want to find some really good 40K t-shirts, look at, I think it's called Redouble. They have so many different things, you know. I mean, they got a whole bunch of just keep calm, you know, and WOG, you know, or keep calm and blood for the blood god, you know, and all those different things. And they got some, you know, I'm steel, I am doom, I march for McCrag, and I know no fear, you know, it's just awesome. And I have to tell you, Ultramarines are one of my favorite chapters, so this is primarily why I got, you know, the blue shirt. But anyway, I wasn't here to talk about 40K, I'm here to talk about Armies of the United States Part 2. Now, if any of y'all are interested in what, you know, what are the different units, in the U.S. Army in bold action, check out my first video, which was part one, which primarily dealt with the infantry spheres. If I didn't say this in my other video, I'll say it now. The purpose of these army lists, well, of going through this book, is not to give you a clear definition of what every single unit is allowed to do. No. I'm just giving y'all a review so this will pique y'all's interest and say, oh yeah, now I'm going to buy that book because it seems like it has everything I want. There's tons more surprises in there, you know, and just, you know, tons of things that are just worth considering. So anyway, so with part two today, let's see, I covered infantry all the way into like more, so now we are on artillery. And pretty much for the rest for this episode, I'm just going to be talking about artillery because there's quite a bit, and there's some interesting things that I would like to talk about. Now, when I first got into bolt action, I never had a big thing for artillery. Because I was like, well, you know, why do you want onboard artillery? You know, artillery, if you look at the section in the rule book, you know, they're really slow, they're, you know, long distance, I mean, they're deadly, you know, and they're not going to foul up on you, meaning that you roll a 1 and, you know, it's... You know, your enemy gets to choose where your artillery strike is. No, it's a lot more reliable than a forward artillery observer. But for me, I was just like, well, they're slow. Once you put them on the board, they're going to stay there. So I'm not really sure if I want to do that. Now, of course, you can have the option of towing, but that's, you know, that's for later. But anyway, I'm going to quickly run through what American artillery is like. So a little description right here is... World War II artillery differed little from that used in World War I. The biggest innovations were in the field of mobility in terms of transport and ammunition, but they were also there were also improvements in the metallurgy and production. Forgive me, guys. Obviously, anti-balloon guns soon became anti-aircraft guns. And with the proliferation of armored vehicles and tanks on the battlefield, it became necessary to develop new anti-tank guns. In order to face the threat of enemy armor, anti-tank guns were developed that could be easily moved and hidden. These opposing tanks became heavier. This led to the demand for larger caliber anti-tank guns. These larger and heavier guns were regarded as too heavy for use by the infantry. For this reason, the anti-tank role was increasingly entrusted to tank destroyer units equipped with highly mobile vehicles carrying heavy guns. So that's the introduction into artillery, as you already know. So first we have light artillery, which is the M1A1. Now, I just decided before I go any further, I'm going to quickly pull out the rule book. Yes, I finally got it. Hooray, hooray. I'm going to look at artillery for a minute. Army. So, the main thing I want to focus on is artillery and movement. This is my primary reason why I'm kind of not the biggest for artillery. Advance, when you give an artillery an order to advance, this order allows the gun to be rotated and placed to face any direction. The gun cannot be brought to bear in this way and fired in the same turn. So basically, advancing for artillery is just repositioning the gun. So, you know, you have it's a 95 degree arc. So if a tank is like, you know, out of your 95 degree arc, you can advance the gun, which is actually just repositioning it. So, yeah. And it can't fire, which kind of stinks. And the run order is this order allows any wheeled light or medium gun and crew to move up to 6 inches in any direction. And it says if artillery crews are reduced to one man, then the unit cannot be issued order. So, I know that artillery is not really meant to be fast, but I guess being like a fast strike mind, I like to have fast units. Now when it comes to anti-tank guns, I'll probably think different. Because if I get into bigger games, which hopefully I will, you know, you'll need more anti-tank power. Okay, so light artillery. This is the, historically, this is the M1A1. You can purchase this artillery piece for 36 points inexperienced, 45 points for regular, and 54 points for veteran. It's 3-man, 1 light howitzer. Let me grab that rule book again. Howitzers are, they have quite an impressive range. A light howitzer has 24 to 48 inches. One shot, its penetration is HE. Let's see. And the HE is D6, so it has a penetration of +2. Now, if you don't know what HE is, look in the rule book and it will tell you. Next, we have medium artillery, which is the M2A1. Now, this is a medium howitzer, so it's like, you know, a little more deadlier. 56 points for inexperienced, 70 points for regular, and 84 points for veteran. Team is four men. Weapon is 1 medium howitzer. Now, with this gun, you can add a spotter for 10 points. Now, if you don't know what a spotter is, look in your rule book again. And essentially what a spotter is, it's like the eyes of the artillery. Essentially, if you have a spotter, you can place them on the battlefield, and whatever the spotter sees, the artillery can see. So even if there's a unit that is if the artillery is not able to see a specific unit, but the spotter can, then you can fire. Because then it's like, you know, the spotter radios in, you know, hey, we got units at 3.5, you know, whatever, you know. So the artillery, you know, they reposition their gun and, you know, start lobbing shells over there. So that's quite useful. But for 10 points, just remember that. Special rules, team weapon, fixed, howitzer. Howitzer means that you can shoot directly or indirectly, if I didn't mention that earlier. The light howitzer has the same rule. And the HE is, as the HE special rule, which is 2d6. The range of a medium howitzer is 18 to 60 inches. So that's quite a far range. One shot. Oh wait, hang on 1 second. I'm looking at the wrong gun. Here we go. 24 to 60 inches. Yeah, there we go. So yeah, it has 2d6 HE and pretty good, you know. Finally, we have the. Let me turn down my music. Probably getting picked up too much. And let me make sure this video is rolling too. Don't want it to stop on me. There you go. Okay, so then we have heavy artillery, which is the M2. 88 points for inexperienced, 110 points for regular, and 132 points for veteran. The team is 5 men, 1 heavy howitzer, spotter, and a heavy howitzer is 24 to 72 inches, one shot, team fixed howitzer HE3D6. So essentially you can get up to 18 wounds if you roll, you know, 3 sixes. It's crazy, you know. I mean, if you get a good shot, you know, here, let me take, you know, just give you an example. You know, so you get a wound, you know, you get a hit on your opponent, you're like, okay, so let's see how many hits. Take your 3d6, roll them. Now, that wasn't too impressive. I only got 8 wounds right there, but hey, if that was an actual squad, you know, they would have been screwed. And HE3D6 has a penetration of 4+. So if they're veteran, that's a 2+. So you're wounding on 2+. So even if when you get 8 dice right there, that's 5, 6, 7, 8. You know, you're going to wound them on a 2+. And that was all 8 troops. So then you would take a morale test. The pin is D6. 2 pins, you know. And then you roll it. I mean, not heavy artillery. I mean, you're just going to blow up. Crap. I mean, it's crazy. So, that's essentially all the artillery. Now, there are a couple other things I would like to mention. And something very interesting that came to my attention. I don't know if other armies have this, but recoilless artillery. Let's see. It says right here, 2 recoilless guns were developed during World War II. The 57mm and the 75mm. These used a cartridge case that was perforated with small holes. This allowed propellant gas to exhaust to the rear through vents surrounding the breech block, producing a counterbalancing force to cancel the gun's recoil. Lack of recoil means that there was no need for heavy mounting, and so the gun could be mounted directly onto a light carriage or even clamped to a vehicle. So, okay, that's pretty cool. Now, so I guess what they are saying right here is that, like, with anti-tank guns and, well, anti-tank vehicles, you know, vehicles with anti-tank guns, this is what they would have. But they allow you to have the ability to use these for infantry. You know, for infantry purposes. And if I were to get artillery, this is probably what I would look at. Because there's only 2 options. You have the 57mm M18. You can buy it for 3 points for regular, or 36 points for veteran. It's a light howitzer, so let's look at that. Look at that again. So it's 24 to 48 inches, one shot, HE, D6. And D6 always has a penetration of 2+. That's pretty good. I mean, now like I said, I don't know if other armies have recoilless artillery. But you're getting long range, heavy suppression for a cheap amount of points. So I think, and I actually don't see any drawbacks. Except that they're light howitzers. I mean, that kind of makes a difference. Oh, excuse me, this howitzer right here is D3. The 57mm is, or the M18 is D3 instead of the normal howitzer, which is D6. So, I mean, that's not too bad. But probably what you will want to go for is the 75mm M20, which you can buy for 45 points for regular or 54 points for veteran. So that's not bad. It's a team of 3 men, 1 light howitzer. This one does have a HED6. So, you know. So that's just like light artillery. Except, yeah, it's pretty much the same price. Yeah. But essentially, I think you get the most advantage if you would buy the 57mm M18. Because that allows you to get an artillery gun that's veteran, that's 36 points, but it's D3. It's just minus, you know, instead of a D6 wounds, it's a D3. But then, you know, that's not too much of a problem. Mainly it's the range, and getting those suppressions, you know. being able to hit your enemy a longer distance. So I thought that that was, you know, at least worth mentioning. Finally, yes, Americans do have the rocket launcher. You can buy it for 52 points in experienced, 65 points for regular, 78 points for veteran. It's a team of four guys. It's a rocket launcher, which is counted as a heavy mortar. Heavy mortars, they have 18 to 72 inches, one shot, HE, team fixed, indirect fire, HE 2d6. So, yeah, that's pretty good. I'm not much one for rocket launchers. And the special rules are team weapon fixed, multiple launcher. I'm not up to date with those rules, so forgive me. Now, anti-tank, anti-aircraft guns. We have, now surely, you know, I guess I'm saying this if there are plenty of dopes out there. If I offend you, I'm sorry. But, you know, anti-aircraft guns, you know. Plane comes over, you know, shooting down. Now some of y'all are like, well, why would you need anti-aircraft guns? Well, if your opponent has a forward air observer, this is going to be priceless. Because if you have anti-aircraft vehicles, you can have the ability to possibly shoot down that plane before the airstrike commences. So just remember that. That's why you would want to look at it. And then bigger games, I will invest my points in anti-aircraft. Too bad they don't have anti-artillery, counter-battery fire, or something like that. That's crazy. Okay, so we have 37mm M1A2 medium anti-aircraft gun. It's 48 points for inexperienced, 60 points for regular, 70 points for veteran. It's a team of four men, one heavy automatic cannon, and it's team weapon, fixed, and flak. Now, flak is a special rule in which you shoot down the aircraft. A heavy automatic cannon... Wait. No. Well, that's kind of strange. I do not see a heavy automatic cannon in here. I think I just ran into a fumble. One heavy automatic cannon. Well, that's strange. A heavy automatic cannon is not listed in here. All that's listed is a light and medium. Well, that's a problem, Warlord. You gotta fix that. A medium automatic cannon is 72 inches, 2 shots. Penetration is 3+, and it's a HED2. So, I don't know. I guess a heavy automatic cannon would be like a D3 HE and a penetration of 4. I'm not really sure. Don't know. So, yeah. So, that's the first option. Next, you have a 90mm M2. Hello, guys. I'm so sorry for that. The stupid camera went off, and I'm about to kick it across the moon. I went off for probably 4 more minutes and then checked it. I was like, oh yeah, I guess I need to check the video and see if it's running. Checked it and it's not even working. So, yeah. Hopefully this one is working. Yeah, it's working. So far. Okay, so I think I last, the video cut off at the, yeah, it cut off at the 90mm, M2 dual-purpose anti-aircraft and anti-tank gun. So this is, you know, like I said, it's dual purpose. You can use it to shoot down aircraft, or you can use it to shoot down artillery. Shoot tanks. I don't think you're going to shoot down artillery because they won't be flying, especially in bolt action. You can purchase them for 148 points for inexperienced, 185 points for regular, or 202 points for veteran. It's expensive. Five men, super heavy anti-tank gun, team weapon, fixed gun, shield, and flak. Now, I just looked at this a moment ago, but I already forgot what it said. I have a bad memory, guys. I'm going to hate it when I grow old. Let's see, super heavy anti-tank gun, 84 inches,
one shot, penetration 7 plus 7, team fixed HED3. So, you know, dangerous on the penetration. You should be able to take out panzers pretty easily, but it's going to cost you bucks. Well, yeah, bucks and points, you know. So that sums up for anti-aircraft guns. Finally, we get into anti-tank. That sums up for anti-aircraft guns. Now we move into anti-tank guns. So first, we have the 37mm anti-tank gun, known as the M3. You can purchase it for 40 points in experience, 50 points regular, 60 points veteran, 3 men, 1 light anti-tank gun, team weapon, fixed, and gun shield. A light anti-tank gun has a penetration of 4 plus, 48 inches, D2, HE. So, yeah. I mean, when you buy it, you're essentially buying a squad of guys, but with better anti-tank capability. It's only a penetration of 4 plus, which is less than a bazooka, but you got range. Just remember that. Next, we have the 57mm anti-tank gun, known as the M1. You can purchase it for 60 points in experience, 75 points for regular, or 90 points for veteran. 3 men, 1 medium anti-tank gun, team weapon, fixed, gun shield. A medium anti-tank gun is 60 inches. The range is 60 inches. 1 shot, penetration 5 plus, team fixed HED2. So, again, better range, just a little more points. And finally, we have the 3-inch anti-tank gun, or the M5. 88 points for inexperienced, 110 points for regular, and 132 points for veteran. 4 men, 1 heavy anti-tank gun, team weapon, fixed gun shield. A heavy anti-tank gun is 72 inches, 1 shot, penetration 6 plus, and a GD3. So now we're finally getting, with anti-tank guns into the bazooka range. Now let me check this and make sure that it's running. Yes, it is. Good. So that sums up American artillery. So now we have a good idea, you do at least, a good idea of what type of artillery is open to you. I would say a lot of options. And you get, the only thing that's lacking, besides the anti-aircraft gun, is a super heavy anti-tank gun. But the dual purpose 90mm anti-aircraft and anti-tank gun would probably be invaluable. Because, you're able to shoot down aircraft and able to shoot tanks. And it's super heavy. So, there you go. You got 84 inches, penetration of 7 plus, Especially if you're running, against Tigers, take that, So, my review on it. Now again, I'm sort of a biased of, I rather have something that will not slow me down. And I kind of consider artillery to be slow, namely because you have a limited options of what you can do. The only thing that I would consider purchasing would probably be recoilless artillery. Because it's cheap, it's artillery, but it's cheap. And even though it's a howitzer, but it has D3 HE instead of a regular, normal light howitzer, which has D6. I'm willing to take that, because, I'm still able to get, 48 inches, still able to hit targets far away, so I think it's worth it, Especially, if you have some tows and such, actual tows, but, a tow truck, and a truck that's not pulling your tows, you can transport artillery a little quicker, so. But yeah, y'all be the judge of it. If y'all have any questions or just opinions, post them in the comments below. Just let me know what y'all think. After the end of this video, I will be posting some pictures of the U.S. Marines I have painted so far. We are going to have our game in February on game night. That's probably going to be it's about a month and a couple of weeks. But it's going to be exciting. Hopefully we're going to have all of our figures painted. So it's going to be marvelous. My guys will be out of place because, the board, it's white. White cover. It's a snowy area. And so my Marines, they're
the transport got a little switcheroo. They were supposed to go to the Pacific, but they ended up going to Finland. So, yeah. They will look a little out of place, but hey, everything will be panning. I'll be looking forward to that. But anyway, guys, hope you enjoyed this video. See you next Tactical Tuesday. And Happy New Year! 2014 is upon us. A year of more exciting wargaming, more bold action games, hopefully, and joys of life. Anyway, guys, take care. See you next Tuesday. Because it's going to be tactical.